Okay, dear friends, dear colleagues, welcome to Higher School of Economics. Welcome to Moscow. Well, I think not all the participants are aware about our university. It was founded exactly 29 years ago in November 1992. And since then, it has become the second largest university in the whole country after Moscow State and the first one in the field of social sciences. We had good luck. Our founder, Yaroslav Kuzminov, was a specialist in the history of economics and institutional economics. And that's why the field of history of economics and the methodology of economics is a privileged field in our university. We represent the special center, which was created for studying history of economics and methodology of economics. And we conduct now the second row of lectures devoted to the relation between economic theory and economic policy. This relation is far from straightforward, as you know, very complicated, and it's very different in different subjects, in different fields of economy, of economic theory. This row of lectures will be devoted to monetary theory and monetary policy. I think you understand very well the importance of this subject today. Every day on television, you can see the manifestations against Mario Draghi, against central banks of all the countries, the monetary policy during COVID epidemic was a very critical issue in economics. And now we're probably beginning to reaping the harvest of this expansionary monetary policy. And so this topic becomes more and more important every day. We have invited four experts in monetary theory and monetary policy from different countries, from Italy, from the United States, from England, professors Riccardo Bellofiore, Sergio Cesaratto, Noemi Levi-Orlik, and Jan Toporowski. And today we'll have the opening session. It will be conducted by Professor Sergio Cesaratto from University of Siena. He's a well-known expert in many fields, but probably monetary theory and monetary policy are among his central topics. So I give the floor to Professor Cesaratto. Please, Sergio, the floor is yours.
Thank you. Thank you very much for the invitation. It's the second time, and sorry if I get some confusion yesterday, and we have a small change in the due to familiar problems, but they are partly solved now. And so let me share the screen so we can follow my presentation. Okay, can you see it? It's all right, thank you. So, it's a long presentation, but we have more than 3 hours, so I think we can deal with it. This is a book I recently published in English, in which many of the topics I will touch upon, and also the European crisis are dealt with. I will present is a theory of money quite different from that which is usually presented in textbooks. But I mean, it's not something strange. The so-called endogenous theory of money is a theory which is shared in many central banks. Many central bankers share the theory I will present on how money is created and how monetary policy works. So I will present anything strange, but I mean something which is supported by many central bankers, maybe not by many economists that still rely on so-called exogenous money yield. Let me begin from something very simple. Something I would call the hierarchy of currencies. And it is the idea that in any economic transaction between two parties, the two parties will use a currency which is issued by somebody which is above the two parties. Of course, let's say in principle, the money, the currency issued by one of the two parties in the transaction, one of the two parties could pay with the money that he or she would issue. I may pay giving you a promise of payment, what the Americans call an IOU. And sometimes this happens. I mean, if you're good friends or your relatives or business firms that trust each other, maybe payments can take place in this way. We want party issuing its own money. But then it will be difficult for the part that is receiving this IOU to use it and for further payments. Sometimes IOU of good quality can be taken, brought to a bank which would advance the value of the IOU as a discount operation, would advance the value of this IOU in legal money, let's say. But I mean, this is a particular case. It happens, but I mean, it's a particular kind of money. I mean, in general, the transaction parties would use a money issued by somebody which is trusted by both sides. So for instance, private individuals in the private sector we use banknotes. Banknotes are used by the central bank, or bank money, deposit which are issued by the commercial banks in their transactions. Commercial banks, when they make transactions among themselves, and we will see that they very often make transactions among themselves, they use a currency issued by the central bank, which is above, in the hierarchy is above the commercial banks. And well, this commercial bank will use bank reserves. Reserves are especially digital money, actually, which is issued by the central bank and is used for payments among banks. And then central banks, we are at the top of the hierarchy, might be transact among themselves using gold or international currencies. International currencies are called reserve currencies because they are a safe asset to hold in official reserves. Some currencies are international currencies, so some other currencies are not. The dollar, the euro, the Swiss franc are international currencies. The Italian lira was called, well, the Turkish lira, they are not international currencies. Why this is easy to understand, the idea of this hierarchy of monies, and then it's very easy to understand how payments by banknotes is done. Less clear is how bank deposits, the currency issued by commercial bank are created and circulated. To this end, let us first introduce a small balance sheet of a commercial bank. This is a very simple balance sheet of a typical standard bank. So we have assets on the left side and liabilities on the right hand side. I'm interested in some entries here, not reserves, which has not necessarily in cash. Reserves is central bank money, which usually is not held in cash, actually. The reserves are held by a commercial bank at the central bank. The commercial banks have a current accounts at the central bank in which they keep reserves. Then we will see how commercial banks obtain these reserves. But anyway, and this is an asset. Central bank money owned by the by a bank. Then on the asset side, we have loans, the credit that our bank has given to the private non-financial private sector. And on the liability side, we find deposits, which is money that actually the bank owns to the customers, the non-financial private sector. And deposits, as you know, are convertible in banknotes. So, I mean, the bank must be sure to have reserves, because in turn the bank can change reserves in banknotes if customers ask to change part of the deposits in banknotes. Anyway, we have loans on the asset side, deposits on the liability side. The point is whether it's deposits that create loans. That is, when a bank receives a deposit, can give a loan to a firm or to a household, or the opposite. Let's say the traditional view of banks is that banks are intermediators of savings. They collect savings, they collect deposits, deposits are savings, and lend these deposits to households and firms. In the traditional view, it's deposit that creates loans. We will see that we will present an alternative view in which loans determine deposits. Before arriving at that, let me give you a simple example of how our payments actually take place. Suppose that this is Monte dei Paschi di Siena, is the old, perhaps the oldest bank in the world. It's a bank. We are in Italy at this moment, or we can be in Russia, or we can be in France, or in a single country. But this is very general. When Paolo wants to make a payment to Francesca, which has the account in another bank, how this transfer of money from bank A to bank B takes place? Well, the idea is that a van with banknotes would go from this bank to this other bank, but I mean, this was in the old times. The payment will take place in this way. Monte dei Paschi di Siena, bank A, will order the Bank of Italy, where banks have their current account in which they keep the reserves. Monte dei Paschi will order Banca d'Italia to transfer, say, 100 euros of reserves to the account of UniCredit. So you see, Monte dei Paschi we can sell 100 euros from the deposit of Paolo. Paolo ordered a money transfer to Francesca. Monte dei Paschi will lose 100 euros of reserves. Mm? UniCredit will get from an extra 100 euros of reserves in its current account at Banca d'Italia, and so it can credit 100 euros in the deposit of Francesca. So you see the payment from Paolo to Francesca take place through a transfer of reserves at the central bank. Hope this is clear. Now, as you know, in many systems, not in all systems, you see that the main purpose of reserves is to allow our payments, our money transfers. That is, reserves are not something, as sometimes is said, something that banks must have to reassure customers that they have enough money in the vault. No. Reserves, the basic reason why reserves exist is to, because through the transfer reserves, our payments takes place. But in many systems, for reasons that we hope to have time to touch upon, banks need also reserves to fulfill, to meet the so-called reserve requirement, which is very small. I mean, in the European Monetary Union at the moment is 1% of deposits. And so we have, in case a reserve requirement, a mandatory reserve requirement exists, there are then reserves exist for two reasons: a reserve requirement to satisfy the reserve requirement, and to use them in payments. Not only in the United States, at the moment, banks haven't any reserve requirement, and neither in England, for instance, in the Bank of England. So, reserves do exist anyway, because they are used in the payments among banks. Now, you see, step one here is that is the payment from Paolo to Francesca, no? Which, as we said, took place with money transfer from the current account of Monte dei Paschi of Bank A to the current account of UniCredit Bank B. Now, you see, UniCredit has received 100 euros of reserves, and Monte dei Paschi has lost 100 euros of reserves. Now, UniCredit has an excess of reserves, in the sense that UniCredit has a new deposit of 100 euros, but in it's only 1 euro. The reserve coefficient is 1%. So 99 euros are an excess of reserves for UniCredit. On the other side, symmetrically, Monte dei Paschi has lost 100 euros of reserves. It has lost also a deposit, but for 100 euros of deposit, Monte dei Paschi needs only 1 euro of reserves. So probably Monte dei Paschi now has 99 euros deficit of reserves. So UniCredit has an excess reserves of 99. Monte dei Paschi has an excess reserves of has a deficit of reserves of 99. A market exists, the interbank market, in which bank with excess reserves lend them overnight to banks short of reserves. So in normal times, you see, UniCredit wants to lend 99 of reserves to Monte dei Paschi, and this takes place again at the is a transfer from the bank's current accounts at the central bank. The central bank would credit 99 of reserves to Monte dei Paschi, and UniCredit will lose 99 of reserves. So this is very so the interbank market is very, very important, because it's as we shall see, the central bank will never leave the aggregate banking system short of reserves. Never. There will be always enough reserves for payments and to satisfy the reserve requirements. But these reserves can be badly distributed. Some banks, because of our payments, I mean, one bank receiving many payments and many reserves, one bank that day losing money, having to make many payments and losing reserves. I mean, nothing strange. The other day is the opposite. And so the interbank market allows banks to, you know, to level to redistribute, so to speak, the reserves. Okay, let us let aside the target to how the payments are done within the European Union, monetary union, or in the United States, where you have a number of regional federal reserves. But in case, I will come back on that. Now, let us arrive at the core of endogenous money theory. As I said, we have in a commercial bank has loans on the asset side. It's money that the bank has lent, and so it's an asset, money that must be one day returned to the bank. And on the liability side, the banks has deposit. In this case, it's money that the bank has to give back on request to us. We hold deposits at banks. Now, how is deposits that create loans or the other way around? Well, look at your experience. Probably many of you are very young, but anyway, imagine that you got your PhD, you get a good job, then you want to buy a house, a new home for you. You go to a bank, ask for a mortgage, for a loan. Can you think that the guy of the bank would say, oh, I have to call the desk, see whether we have collected a new deposit so I can lend you the money? Really, it doesn't work like that. Or another story is that to create deposits, banks, or create loans, to generate loans, banks must have reserves. But it doesn't work like that. The officer of the bank will not call the reserve department saying, well, do we have enough reserves? The commercial bank, the officer of the bank, is interested that you have a good job, you are honest, and you are able in the future to return the loan, pay the interest on the loan, and return the loan in the next years. Then by, you know, striking the keyboard or writing something, he will say, okay, you are asking me, I don't know, 100,000 euros to buy a new house. Well, I created a new deposit for you in which you will find 100,000 euros. Which is a liability for me. I'm the bank, it's a liability. On request, I must give you this money, even on banknotes, if you ask. But on my asset, I can write a new loan. You one day must give this money back to me. So you see, the balance sheet of the commercial bank is in perfect equilibrium. It's the creation of a new deposit was created a new loan. When I didn't know this theory, a couple of decades ago, I opened a mortgage. I was surprised of the insistence. I had not my current account at that bank. It was UniCredit. I had not my current account. I had my current account in another bank, Banca Nazionale del Lavoro. And they insisted, no, you, if you want to give you a loan, but you must open a deposit with us. Well, the reason is precisely this one. Because loans are created, generating new deposits. The commercial method has not to collect deposit in order to lend. And another objection is that, okay, but if there is a mandatory reserve requirement, if the commercial bank give you a loan of 100,000 euros, it must have 1,000 euros, 1% reserves. No, it is not a problem for the bank. Two, banks have to comply with the reserve requirement, but they have time to do that. The reserve requirement, there is a period which is in Europe is of 6 weeks, called the maintenance period. Banks, and the 6 weeks are between the meetings of the governing council of the ECB. So during 6 weeks, banks have to fulfill the reserve requirement, 1% of deposit, as an average. So one day they can have 1.2% of reserves, and the other day have zero. On the deposit of the previous maintenance period. So they know, the central bank knows how many deposits they held in the previous maintenance period. In this period, they have to fulfill the reserve requirement, not daily, as an average over the period, in relation to the deposit of the former period. So, I mean, and all weeks, the ECB, but this story applies to, I believe, to most or all central banks in the world. Every week, the central bank will hold refinancing operations. That is, there is a desk every week at which a bank can ask for new reserves. And we will see that the central bank will never fail to provide banks with the necessary reserves. So reserves are not a preoccupation. So in short, because I mean that the story that reserves are the key, we'll come back on that. But you see, neoclassical theory, mainstream theory, has two ideas. Banks intermediate savings. So it's deposits that generate loans. My bank has to collect deposit in order to lend. Wrong. Other mainstream theory, we come back on that, is the monetary multiplier, the deposit or deposit multiplier. The reserves, banks must have reserves. If they have extra reserves, they can create deposit and loans. Wrong. They don't need the reserves to create loans and create deposits. They have time to collect the necessary reserves. So the endogenous money theory or a fact, I mean, it sounds more as a fact because it's something that, you will experiment yourself going to when you will ask a loan from a bank. the officer will never call the desk to see whether the bank has collected deposit, or the reserve department to see whether they have enough reserves. The officer will be interested in the fact that you are a trustee that can trust you. That's all. So the mandatory money theory, in short, of fact, it's that credit, creating a loan, generate deposits, and then reserves are generated by the central bank. That we'll never see why let banks short of reserves. This is clear. Just a digression, how banknotes are generated. Well, banknotes are generated when you go to a automatic teller, of course, called automatic cash dispenser or whatever, and you want to withdraw some banknotes. Automatically, your bank will say you want 10 euros banknotes. The automatically your deposit is cut by 10 euros. In the meantime, the central, your bank will have exchanged 10 euros of reserves in banknotes. And then when you make the operation at the cash dispenser, the UniCredit will give you the 10 euros in banknotes. So you see the balance sheet of UniCredit has remained balanced, in the sense that all the operations balance each other. So banknotes are generated by banks. Banknotes are generated by a central bank that give them to banks in exchange of reserves. And then these banknotes are given to the public on request. But the public will, of course, lose a part of the deposits. Well, as I said, an exogenous money view is instead held by traditional mainstream economics, although not by most of central bankers, and also not by some mainstream scholars. As I said, in traditional neoclassical economics, banks intermediate savings, they collect deposits, savings, and they lend them to firms for investment. It's what is the history of economic thought is called loanable funds theory. Then the equilibrium, we know from neoclassical theory that the equilibrium price between saving and investment is the natural interest rate. The natural interest rate is the rate at which full capacity savings, let's say savings generated by fully utilized resources. We are in the neoclassical framework, so with labor, with markets flexibility, resources are always fully utilized. So full capacity savings is the amount of savings generated by a fully utilized capacity. The natural interest rate is the rate at which full capacity savings are equal to investment. This recalls the target of the general theory, that is the Say's law, the idea that I hope you know what Say's law is. It's the idea that demand is not relevant from a macroeconomic aggregate demand is not relevant for the macroeconomic equilibrium, in the sense that full capacity output supply would generate an equal amount of demand. It's true that student part of income is saved, but we are sure that through the natural interest rate, the full capacity saving are transformed in an equal amount of investment. Well, in traditional neoclassical economics, the amount of deposit that banks can create depends on amount of them. Say something more here. The idea of the loan amount funds theory, the idea that banks intermediate savings is linked to this saving investment, to this neoclassical saving investment relations. What, by collecting deposit, in this traditional view, banks are collecting savings. And what banks should do in equilibrium is to lend these deposits, these savings, at the natural interest rate. Because if they do that, the economy will remain in full employment. So the natural interest rate is the theoretical interest that put in equilibrium capacity savings and investment, and that it is the same equilibrium rate that that banks should adopt in order that capacity saving deposits are lent to firms for investment, and the economy would remain in equilibrium. So banks intermediate savings in equilibrium at the natural interest rate. Another tenet of neoclassical theory is the idea that reserves generate deposit that generate credit. This is the reason why this is called an exogenous money theory. Because reserves are a creature of the central bank. So the central bank decides the amount of reserves, and the amount of reserves generate potential deposit of commercial banks, and the amount of commercial deposit generates credit. And the relation between reserves and deposits and credit is captured by the well-known monetary or deposit multiplier that I'm sure you have studied at school. You see the sequence of the exogenous money theory is the opposite of endogenous money theory. Of course, the central bank must, in the classical world, must create the correct amount of reserves, in the sense that the amount of deposit in this in a classical economy correspond to full capacity savings. So the amount of reserves must be that generates an amount of deposits equal to capacity savings. I should say that I've never found a decent textbook exposition of this idea. Perhaps in very advanced textbooks, but mathematics is placed the most relevant. Let me go a second back to the deposit or monetary multiplier. It's a formula that you should know. I mean, the amount of deposit, the potential deposits generated by banks, the potential amount of deposit that banks can generate depends on the base money reserves plus banknotes generated by the central bank. And gamma alpha, gamma is the reserve coefficient, 1%. No, we are measuring Europe, for instance. And alpha is the amount, the share of money that the public wants to retain in banknotes as a share of deposits. So you see, exogenous money generated by central bank determines the amount of banks' money and also the amount of loans. In this theory, perhaps you remember what you learned at the first years of your university courses, when banks receive reserves, they can lend them out, only retaining a share to meet reserve requirements. It is true, in a sense, that also in this theory, banks generate credit by creating deposits. In the sense that a bank must receive reserves first. Then if a bank has an excess of reserves, it would lend them, creating a deposit in favor of a borrower. But but the process starts with the availability of reserves. And the demand for credit is a function of supply. I mean, the availability of credit, potential credit by banks, always meet a demand of credit from firms or households, which is a sort of sales law of credit. The supply of credit creates its own demand. What is really unsustainable? Many textbooks, it said that when banks have excess reserves, they lend these excess reserves. This is just ridiculous. That is, reserves circulates only in the current accounts of banks at the central bank. Reserves cannot circulate in our deposit. I mean, the banks cannot lend reserves to us. This is totally stupid, but this is what is told in textbooks. By the way, as I documented, I mean, this is not exactly, I mean, was struck particularly by a sentence by Ulrich Wintzail, which is one of the top economists at the ECB, he's a German economist, who said, I've been working at central banks, the Bundesbank first, then the ECB for decades, and I have never had a discussion in the managing councils or among the directors of the bank, the central bank, I've never heard anybody mentioning this, the monetary or deposit multiplier. It's something that central banks simply ignore. I mean, exists in textbooks, but something wrong, because I mean, the deposit multiplier suggests that reserves generate deposit that generate credit, which is not the way the world. And then the stupid proposition that banks, commercial banks, lend the reserves. Jesus, the reserves are only in the current account of banks, and the banks cannot lend the reserves to, can lend reserves to other banks, but not to us. Digression. If with there is a lot of talk of digital digression, of digital currencies nowadays, and if central banks will allow us to have current accounts at the central bank, what is called central bank digital currencies. All central banks are preparing their own digital currency. Digital currency means that a central bank digital currency means that we can have current account at the central bank. In that case, I don't know. I mean, it's possible that banks can lend us reserves, but the central bank digital currency for us do not exist. So there is no way we can be lent reserves. So summing up the neoclassical exogenous money view, saving determines investment, banks intermediate savings, deposits, reserves create deposit that generates credit. A second associated to this view is the standard macroeconomic textbooks presentation of monetary policy. In this, the standard view that many points of, um, from in this standard view of monetary policy, the central bank controls the interest rate moving, maneuvering the quantity of money. And the standard story is that if the central bank was to decrease the interest rate in order to stimulate credit, the central bank would, given a demand for money, the central bank would increase the money supply and the interest rate would fall. On the other side, if the bank wants to adopt a more deflationary stance, it would supply bonds and withdraw liquidity from the market, and the interest rate would rise. So this standard view, the monetary policy, that is the control of the interest rate, is based on changes in the money supply. I mean, this is also totally wrong. We will see the central banks cannot move the money supply as they wish. They will create a mess in the banking system. When we say that the central banks move the money supply, means that the central bank is moving the supply of reserves. Remember, give your intuition, remember that reserves are precious, are important for banks to make our payments and to fulfill the reserve requirement. The central bank cannot move this quantity. So the banks need a precise amount of reserves in a certain moment. The central bank cannot move this supply and the supply of reserves as it wishes. The change in interest rate does not take place through open market operations. As we shall see, it will take place through open mouth operation. The central bank announces a new level of the interest rate without moving the money supply. Otherwise, we will make a mess. Okay. Oh, this is the view held at central banks, ECB, or even Bundesbank. I mean, this is something we have already mentioned. The natural interest rate is the same in the market. This is in a classical view again. Of course, in the neoclassical monetary theory, the central bank wants to, the target of the central bank is the natural interest rate. Okay, that the bank, the central bank doesn't know the natural interest rate, because the natural interest rate is the result of an equilibrium between capacity savings and investment. And this is a theoretical equilibrium. Nobody has ever estimated these functions. What we see is the loanable funds market, the demand for credit and supply of deposits. And the central bank is targeting an interest rate which would put in equilibrium demand for credit and the supply of deposit, but behind these, let's call them visible functions, there is the invidia numeno, in Platonic terms, of the saving and investment demand, supply and demand. The slides stop to move. A problem with the slides. Okay. Sorry. Where are we? Okay. So the objective of monetary policy in a classical theory is the natural interest rate. Um, The endogenous money theory is more consistent with the Keynesian relationship between savings and investment. As you know, in Keynes and in Michael Kalecki, it is investment that determines savings through the income Keynesian income multiplier. But then the question, if it's investment that determines savings, the questions would rise, who is financing investment? Here the endogenous money view would provide the answer. Is the investment is financed by money creation by commercial banks. I'll give you, provide you simple examples. Here is this, is a standard example of the Keynesian multiplier. Suppose that in period one, there is an investment decision by 100 euros or whatever. This investment decision is financed by credit creation by a commercial bank. So the commercial bank creates a loan, a deposit. By giving a loan, it creates a deposit in favor of the investor. Then the investor will spend this 100 euros. A new machinery will be produced, so output would increase by 100. And this the value this income is partly spent in consumption goods, so the production of consumption goods the next period will increase by 80, and assuming a propensity to consume 0.8, 80%. 20 is saved. You see, look at the then 80 of consumption goods are produced, so income will increase by 80, and again 80% is spent in consumption goods, and 20% is saved, and so on and so forth. As you see, the result is that because of initial investment by 100, income has increased 500, consumption 400, and 100 of savings are generated. So it's an investment that determines savings. What about the deposit? The deposit will change hands. I mean, the deposit here, for instance, the deposit initially is held by the investor, then is paid to the labor and the capitalist of and the to labor and to the owner of the investment good that produce that had produced the produced the investment goods. Then the labor and the owner of the capital good produce the firm they would transfer this the past part of the deposit they will keep and part will transfer and so on and so forth. So through part of the deposit that each round is saved and part of the deposit is transferred to other labor workers or the firm's owners. So the deposits changing hands. At the end, the deposit will is still 100, of course. And at the end, this you see the amount finally, the deposit is precisely equal, is also equal to the amount of savings. It means that at the end of this the multiplier process, savings are backed by a deposit. These deposits are savings. But you know, this is an ex post result of the income multiplier process. At the beginning, investment has been financed out of credit money creation by a bank. Deposit savings emerge only at the end, ex post. And at that point, you can say, too, now, this bank has this bank has created a loan of 100, and this is backed by a deposit of 100. which is savings. Perfect. But only ex post deposits are a saving, not ex ante. We can also imagine a story in which savers wish to hold part of their savings in securities, while in turn the investor issues security. You can imagine that when people receive save part of their income during the multiplier process, part of this income is held in deposit, a part they want to. Households want to invest in bonds, in the financial asset and securities. We may imagine, with a little of imagination, we may think that the investor, which initially has been financed from the bank, was created a deposit in his favor or her favor. We can imagine that then the investor wants to finance his invest or her investment on a longer term way. So he would issue securities, collect, sell the securities to households, and the investor can give the money back to the bank. So the investor has received from a bank a short period, short-term loan, then issue securities to finance investment on a longer term. So he would collect deposit from the households and return the money, the short-term loan to the bank. So you see that money is created by banks by generating loans and is destroyed when loans are returned to the banking system. So banks' money deposits, which is mass money, is banks' money, commercial banks' money, are generated through the creation of loans and are destroyed when these loans are returned to the bank. In this example, households will keep most of the savings in securities, and these securities are issued by the investor that in this way can finance most of the investment on the longer term basis. So at the end, you know, savings consist of 10 of deposits and 90 of securities. Oh, a note of the history of economic thought. Can you see it in this way? It's good enough without I use the full presentation. So I'm sure that I can go down. A note of history of economic thought. Keynes is very ambiguous he's divided, he's a double soul. Party believes in endogenous money theory, part on exogenous money theory. The general theory, money is exogenous. After you see, in the general theory, the interest rate is determined by the money demand, which is based on the liquidity preference theory, and money supply. And so then the central bank controls the interest rate by moving the money supply. And this is an exogenous money view, and this is the view that then we find also in textbooks. What is interesting that only in the treatise of money, 1931, he had an endogenous money view instead, but more importantly, after the general theory, 1937-1938, Keynes wrote a number of articles which were concerned on financing of investment. In this case, Keynes, with some ambiguities, had held something that which is very close to endogenous money view. investment are financed. Because the general theory leave us with a question. I mean, the general theory find also the idea that it's investment that generates savings. But then in the general theory, Keynes does not explain who is financing investment. And in these articles, after the general theory, it took the direction of endogenous money view. The question is very, very interesting because one point I want to tell you, I've said that the endogenous money view fits very well with the Keynesian investment saving relationship. I mean, endogenous money finds investment that generates savings and deposits. But I mean, this endogenous money view and even the Keynesian multiplier are perfectly consistent also with neoclassical theory. Indeed, great neoclassical economists, for instance, Knut Wicksell, believed that banks can create credit. And in the neoclassical synthesis of Hicks, Modigliani, Samuelson, etc., in the neoclassical synthesis, you can find the Keynesian multiplier. The problem is that the key difference between an heterodox and an orthodox view of macroeconomics is not endogenous money. Endogenous money, as I said, it sounds more a fact than a theory, and is shared in central banks. The central banks are not much Keynesian. They're absolutely not heterodox in no sense. They are very, very orthodox. They believe in endogenous money. Because the very difference between an orthodox and heterodox view in monetary, in macroeconomics in general, monetary theory more specifically, is you believe or not in a natural interest rate. That there is a price that put in equilibrium full capacity savings and investment and the economy has no problem of aggregate demand. In a classical view, the central bank control the interest, tries to target a natural interest rate that it doesn't see, but I mean, the central bank would reason, I would say, if in the economy there is inflation, then the monetary interest rate is too high. If there is deflation, the monetary interest rate is too low. So, I mean, when inflation is constant or prices are stable or there is 2%, say, of inflation rate, then it means that the central bank has obtained that the monetary interest rate is equal to the natural interest rate. Is this part of the story that heterodox economists would disagree? And we will come back say something about that. Okay, now, so let us begin the tomorrow lecture. We have 20 minutes more, right?
Yeah, you have 20 minutes, but I would suggest you to leave like 5 to 7 minutes for questions.
7 minutes?
So okay. You have like 10, 15 minutes.
Okay, let me just introduce, let me say something, just a last remark about what I said up to now. As I said, endogenous money theory is shared by, can be shared also by mainstream economists. What marks the difference between heterodox and orthodox economists, post-Keynesian and orthodox economists, is the, if you believe or not in the natural interest rate. And there might be various reasons why one doesn't believe in a natural interest rate. One reason is that are the results of the capital theory controversy between the two Cambridges and the problems of neoclassical capital theory. I don't know whether you have heard about this controversy, but I mean, it was a great big controversy that took place in the 60s between Cambridge, MIT in the United States and Cambridge in Britain about the foundation of neoclassical theory. Was a very analytical controversy, not an ideological controversy. And the British, I would say the Italian side, there were a number of Italian economists in Cambridge. The Italian side won the battle, but unfortunately not the war. Nobody is talking anymore about that. And this is the best strategy, you know, obscuring this, not talking about what happened at the 60s, the defeat of the neoclassical theory. So young people doesn't know about that, and it's the best way to avoid any problem, any criticism, newly criticism for mainstream economics. Anyway, there is the endogenous money view is linked to description or illustration of monetary theory as it really as it works in the real world. So I take 5 minutes more, Dennis, okay? Yeah. As I said, monetary policy cannot work as described in textbooks. That is, with the central bank moving, given the demand of money, with the central bank moving the money supply. The amount of reserves for banks cannot be changed at will by the central bank. Otherwise, it would make a mess. And it would fail monetary policy targets. We have seen that according to endogenous money theory, credit generates deposit, which generates reserves. So let us start by looking at how central bank generates the reserves demanded by banks. So there is a demand of reserves by banks because reserves are useful and necessary to make payments, our payments, that take place to the transfers of reserves among banks, and to fulfill, in case it exists, to fulfill the mandatory reserves requirement. As I said, what I'm saying here, according to the textbooks, it is indifferent for the central bank. In textbooks, you also read that for central bank is the same to have as an imperative target the supply of money or the interest rate. It's the same to if the central bank maneuver the interest rate or the money supply. In actual, the operative targets of central banks has always been the interest rate, even in the monetarist decades when the target was the quantity of money. I mean, in actual central bank, we're still targeting, the real target was the interest rate and not the supply of money. So it's not true that it's the same, having as a target, the money supply of the interest rate is the same. Obviously, the final objective, the final target of the central bank would be different among different central banks. For instance, the ECB has a certain level of the interest rate as a target. Now, since last July, the target of the ECB is a 2% interest rate. They have 2% inflation rate. Before it was below but close to 2%. Now it's 2%. Whereas, for instance, the Federal Reserves are both 2% of the inflation rate of 2%, and also maximum employment. So the final target of the central bank is decided by the politicians, not by, of course, as Kenz said, the politicians are influenced by past economists. Dennis, I think I may stop here because maybe we have said enough today. What do you think?
Oh, it's up to you. Let's collect questions. Yes, why not? Actually, I see at least one question from Andrei.
Okay, where can I see it? Is a written question?
No, it's, I think.
Please go ahead.
Thank you for interesting lecture. I just have a question. We now know that some central banks are planning to introduce digital currencies, not cryptocurrencies, but digital currencies, apart from the traditional reserves and cash money. And what do you think, whether this policy will change any theory or will be some additional chapter in theoretical debates?
Thanks for this question. I mentioned the central bank digital currencies earlier. Central bank digital currency is simply that we might have a current account at the central bank. So a very safe current account. The question is that, first question is that if then there is a bank run, suppose. A bank run is when people perceive some instability in the banking system. Bank run means that people goes to the banks and wants to collect. The classical bank run is people wants to collect banknotes. Okay, in case you have a central bank digital currency, a bank run will consist of people going to the bank, asking to transfer the money to the central bank, to the current account at the central bank. So is if people start to be worried about the solidity, the stability of the banking system, if you have a systemic banks crisis, and you might have a bank run not consisting of a withdrawal of banknotes, but people asking to transfer the deposits to the central bank, which is the same because having a deposit at a central bank or having a banknotes is the same. You have central bank money in your hands. Okay, your deposit at a central bank is the modern digital equivalent of a banknot. It's central bank money. So for instance, I know that the ECB wants to put a limit to avoid that in case of a panic, this massive transfers of deposit from banks to the central bank, want to put a limit of 3,000 euros for our deposit at the ECB. I have not a precise opinion about the story of the central bank digital currencies. Really, the situation is evolving. Many economists say, but why? I mean, we are digital. The banking system is already digital. The question of private digital currencies should be solved with regulations. Instead, they are left, without the regulation. It's horrible. Well, as you know, digital currencies are divided in stable coins, if they promise you convertibility in legal money, or crypto assets, Bitcoin, and this sort of, which are speculative assets. But there is a question of regulation of this field. Perhaps offering a central bank digital currency, the central bank want to make some competition entering this new market. Let's say we are able to offer people a safe digital currency. So if you want to be competitive, you must do the same, offer something very safe. So there might be quite a problem, but many economists say it's not clear why. I mean, if you regulate very well the private digital currencies, and very, very well, because they are used, you know, for mafia payments and all these things, then perhaps we don't need the central bank digital currency. It's really a question that is still discussed. I mean, if we really need the Anyway, as far as you limit the amount of money we can keep at the central bank, for instance, 3,000 euros, this one will not create many problems to commercial banks.
Thank you.
Thanks. Thank you. Yeah, there is another question.
Next question, Davut, please.
Thank you very much, Professor, for the lecture. It was a pleasure to listen to you. I had like four short questions, because the endogenous money system you have explained, why would the central banks be unwilling to unveil it to the masses? There is this, I mean, why wouldn't they tell us how the money system really works? Why would they still insist on this classical model, loanable funds, that we need to have reserves and stuff? Like, why are they hiding from us? Is there a point in, you know, doing so?
You have other questions.
Yeah, and what is the role of reserve requirement and interest rate in what you are saying, endogenous money system?
Yeah.
Because it is understandable in loanable funds. Presumably there is this market interest rate, but in endogenous money, what is the role of reserve if central bank can always
answer the first two questions. Now, nowadays, central banks, even the Bundesbank, believe in endogenous money theory. As I said, they don't talk about deposit multipliers or these kind of things. As I said, the classical, so, I mean, they can be orthodox, believe in the standard theory, but standard theory is consistent with endogenous money theory. I feel endogenous money theory is even more consistent with a Keynesian view. But I mean, it's consistent also with this, neoclassical mainstream economics. So, central banks are orthodox because they must, you know, keep inflation low and the wage conflict, calm down the wage conflict, create unemployment is a wage claim like too strong, etc. But I mean that they can share the endogenous money view. As to the second question, why the role of reserves in the endogenous money view of mandatory reserves? Okay, banks need reserves for payments, so this is true even without mandatory reserves. We can answer the next lecture in the sense that the central bank, because the central bank announce the interest rate, it doesn't touch the supply of money. Yeah. And the interest rate it announces is the interest rate on the reserves it lends. So by introducing a mandatory reserve requirement, the central bank increases the need of reserves of banks. And so, yes, most since the the policy interest rate target of the central bank is the interest rate on the supply of reserves. By increasing the necessity of reserves by banks, the central bank has much more power. I mean, I offer you something you really need for payments, but also for the mandatory reserve requirement. And so, you know, I have a stronger power as a monopolist in the reserve supply, and you really need them. And so I have a strong power on the price of what I'm selling. There is a third reason that mandatory reserves are a buffer for banks, in a sense. As I said, they have to fulfill the reserve requirement, say 1% of deposits in the euro system, the euro system. Not daily. One day they can have 2% of reserves, excess reserves, and one day they can go to zero. This flexibility is useful for banks because in case one day, for instance, they lose a lot of reserves because its customers are making a lot of payments. Paolo sending a lot of money to Francesca. So Monte dei Paschi is losing money to reserves to UniCredit. Well, UniCredit has Monte dei Paschi, who short of reserves, can ask them to UniCredit. But I mean, perhaps he has an excess reserves because it's a day in which the day before entered a lot of reserves and can use them. So he has mandatory reserves are not necessarily kept there. Idle can be used for also for make payments and maybe in days in which the banks is short of reserves. The important is that then on the average of the maintenance period, the requirement is fulfilled. So during the last day, the banks tends to, you know, knows that the last day she must have fulfilled. But during the maintenance period, she can use reserves, mandatory reserves for payments. So it's a buffer, it's a, you know, give the banks more flexibility. And we will see this also help the central bank is on, the central bank wants always to satisfy, we will see the demand of reserves of banks. But if there are mandatory reserves, she know that banks have never really short of reserves on a daily basis, in the sense they can use mandatory reserves for payments. So where there are no mandatory reserves, like in England, the central bank must intervene in the market to adjust the supply of reserves every day. In the ECB, every week. Because banks are having a mandatory reserve are never really short of reserves, although over 6 weeks they must fulfill the requirement.
Okay, yeah.
This is useful.
Okay.
I put at the end of my presentation, there is a short bibliography, there are references to some lectures, some papers were very clear on these things.
Okay, and Professor, if I could ask, like, if there is...
Yeah.
Two last questions. The first question is about normativity, because we have this real economy where industries work, where startups, entrepreneurs work hard to earn real money. And on the other hand, we have these central banks, which are simply creating money on demand, like you suggested. And to what extent is it ethical to give unearned money on interest rate? Because on the other hand, I, as a entrepreneur, have to work hard in order to make that principal plus interest rates. And last question, Professor, if I could, hard currency, what do you think? Like, so that currency is bound to metal, gold or silver. What do you think? Is it doable? Thank you very much.
No, the third question on the is if it's ethical to leave banks this power to create money to central bank and also to commercial banks. Yeah. The commercial banks have the power to create money. Well, this reminds of it's a topic a bit complicated. Fortunately, I have only a paper, a chapter of the book in Italian. I will translate in English at the point. It's a question that is curiously linked to the central bank digital currency question. In the 1930s, a group of American economists, very famous, Irving Fisher, which was probably the most known American economist at the time, said that, you see, banks were responsible of the financial crisis. They create a lot of credit to firms, to households, probably to finance speculation. Because one simple answer is that as long as banks create money for entrepreneurs, it's very Keynesian. I mean, entrepreneurs want to invest and banks finance investment. This is a traditional bank, which is fine. I mean, we can accept. I mean, the traditional bank is a service creation of bank money that is used for investment or for us when we need a loan to buy a house, to buy a new car, etc. Hope we stop buying cars one day. A more complex reply would refer to this what was called a Chicago plan, because there were mostly economists from Chicago. They said they had an endogenous money view. They said banks, commercial banks, can create loans, and since these loans are not always created for good purposes, they create financial bubbles or construction bubbles, they generate instability. This power to create money generates instability. So they had this idea of 100% of reserves. Banks must cover, you must have 100, for any loan you create, you must have 100% of reserves. Which means that the power to create credit is given to the central bank, because a bank cannot create, in this case, cannot create a loan to a firm by typing, striking the keyboard, typing something. It must ask the central bank, give me a correspondent amount of reserves. So at the end, it's the central bank that decides the amount of loans created in the last decisions anyways on the central bank, which is very similar to, at the end, banks are only useful to, they say in English, to prepare a report on the borrower, say the borrower is a good person, has a good wage or whatever, you can trust it, pass this report to the central bank, and the central bank create the loan, creating an equal amount of reserves. So you cut the power. There are aspects of the Chicago plan that I did not understand. They wanted to go back to the intermediate, to the conception of banks as intermediator of savings. It's strange because they start saying banks can create loans. At the end, they propose to go back to the wrong conception. And it's not clear how. And anyway, they have this idea that anyway, loans can be covered by 100% of reserves, which means that it's as if we had a digital currency, because our deposit is covered 100% by reserves. It's as if we had a loan deposit directly at the central bank. So the Chicago plan now has been rediscussed again in connection with central bank digital currencies. It's as if banks are not the precise role. Anyway, but behind our deposit, there is 100% of reserves. It's as if we had a super safe deposit directly at the central bank. The banks is an intermediator between us and the central bank, but no more than that. So it's very, very fascinating in a sense. If we keep in touch, you can write me if when I will translate this chapter anyway, I can suggest you some readings if you write me privately on this precise aspect of Chicago plan and endogenous money, digital currencies. Okay. I have not an opinion about a core money. I look at that the golden standard, not only the golden standard, but I say it's also the euro.
Yes.
With the euro, for instance, Italy adopted the foreign currency. We are not anymore a central bank, but let's go to the gold standard. This fixed, but the euro and the golden standard have been assimilated. Because the euro is a fixed exchange system among a number of European countries. This fixed exchange rate system, gold standard of the euro, are a way to to constrain the social conflict. Social conflict creates inflation. Inflation means that your prices are growing, increasing more than the prices of competitors, foreign competitors. And you would use your currency devaluation, you know, to adjust competitiveness. So it's a model that, for instance, Italy had in the 70s, a high inflation, but we could devalue the lira. And so the conflict could go on somehow. And the workers won. that is not true that the workers were losing. It's not a great model. I would prefer income policy, but I would prefer better social compromise, not this high conflict. But anyway, if you have a fixed exchange rate system, if workers' wage claims are too high and generate inflation and lose of competitiveness, once you are in the euro, you cannot devalue it anymore. So social conflict would generate unemployment. So trade unions must be quiet. And the same, Hayek and Green, I think, the one most important international monetary economist of the United States, Hayek and Green, said that the gold standard was abandoned after the First World War in Western countries because it was not democratic. Also, Danny Goldrick at Harvard University says that fixed exchange rates are not democratic. They do not allow social conflict. By fixing the parities with gold or with the euro or whatever, they are anti-inflationary. But, you know, the inflation is the result of social conflict. And you to have in a democracy, you must allow some social conflict. Although I think it should be solved through social compromise, not, you know, conflict is. It's the last resort. I would prefer social compromise. But anyway, fixed exchange rate systems, like the gold standard, and in the extreme, the adoption of gold, you would put a deflationary pressure on the economy, and you keep social conflict at bay, under control. So it's not very democratic. But I mean,
I would kindly not agree with that point, but I really respect. Thank you very much.
Thanks a lot.
Thank you. Actually, we have run out of our time. Maybe one, if there is one or two short questions. Are there? Carlo and Evgenia, please just one short question.
Yes, can I ask a question?
Yes. And thank you, Professor, for this lecture, and thank you for the organizers, because I am basically seeing this from Croatia, from University of Zagreb, so thank you. Very short, Professor, when you mentioned very briefly Target 2 payment system, are you going to talk maybe tomorrow about it? If yes, that's all right. I'm very...
It's a pretty complicated question, but please send them tomorrow, remind me, I will say something about that.
All right, and the second one, very shortly, you said reserves are never lent out. I agree, even though in the money multiplier model, excess reserves are kind of go to credit, which is wrong. But was it always like that? Was it also like that in the 19th century, 20th century? Was it always the closed payment system of reserves? That's it. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Yeah, you don't find me well prepared on this aspect. In spite of what was said in the introduction, I become a little monetary expert, but not that much. I did not spend my life studying monetary theory. So I don't know. I mean, I suppose there are two theses, those that say that endogenous money comes at the top, but that of an evolution of banking, but banks were at the beginning, they were collecting gold or specie, they were collecting wealth, and then they as custodians to protect this wealth, and then they learned they could lend it. I have not an opinion. Endogenous money creation, certainly government at a point learned that they could issue money and print money, but I've not a precise reply. Sorry for that. And on Target 2, yes, I know very well the story. It's a bit not complicated, but I will try to mention it tomorrow to say something. Then you can write me and we can discuss it privately.
Thank you. Yevgenia, please.
Good evening, Professor. Can you hear me?
Yeah, we can hear you.
Thank you. Thank you for your lecture. And I have a question about, you have said, as I understood during the lecture, that central banks can't change money supply directly as they wish. But what about helicopter money? Doesn't helicopter money mean that it is a direct increase in money supply by central banks? Thank you.
Yeah, it's a good question. Indeed, one of alleged advantage of central bank digital currency is precisely that the government would have the power through the central bank to distribute helicopter money to, if all citizens have a central bank current account, helicopter money becomes very easy. The government might order the central bank to put 500 euros in the account of each citizen, and that's done. The criticism, the more orthodox criticism, that then you give the government, you mixed fiscal and monetary policy. Fiscal policy would act, to money create through money creation. So, but I think that anyway, even without central bank digital currency, helicopter money, the idea of helicopter money is that is financed out of money creation by the central bank. Central bank would create banknotes, and these banknotes are distributed to people, or the central bank would create reserves. Not only banks have a current account at the central bank, also government can have up to now is the only other subject that can have a current account at the central bank. So the central bank could create reserves, put them in the current account of government, and the government distribute these reserves in our current account. So, I mean, anyway, the idea of the Ecoptec money, that would, if we have a current account directly at the central bank, it would be easier. But anyway, the idea of the Ecoptec money is that create money, give it to people will spend and the economy would recover. So, but the question was right, is a facilitator with a central bank digital currency would be a facilitator of helicopter money.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you. I think that we should leave more time for questions tomorrow, because I see the great interest and we have like 50 people here who still with us, who are waiting for answers, who are fascinating as all we, I think, with this lecture. So let us wait for tomorrow, maybe, and let us ask Professor Cesarato questions for tomorrow. And let us congratulate Professor Cesarato and ourselves with this wonderful start of our online lectures on monetary theory and monetary policy.
Okay. Thank you to all of you for your patience.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
See you tomorrow.